Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this beautiful afternoon. In the name of Jesus Christ, rebuild and bind every foul wicked evil spirit. We're going to go from here right now in Jesus' name, that your word may have recourse in the midst of us. Lord, we believe that you're going to speak to us in a very personal way, that our life, our business, our relationship going to be transformed. We thank you and praise you for the much more surpassing favor in Jesus' most precious name. And other people say, amen. Now, Jesus Christ mentioned that he who believes in me, in him will flow rivers of running water. So when you believe in Jesus, the Holy Spirit is already in you. But you see, the Holy Spirit doesn't want to just sit in, doing nothing. He wants to flow out in rivers. All right? That means amazing power in your everyday life. The Bible tells us in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, you will be receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. In other words, God wants you to be energized. The word power in the Greek is where we get the word dynamite. How about to have more dynamite in your relationship, in your profession, all right? Whatever that you do, you want to have dynamite, man. You want the rivers, that river liquid dynamite coming out. You know, just yesterday, Pastor Vernon was talking about during the miracle rally, he's talking about this witch go to every church. And every time the sermon is on, the worship is on, he would curse. He disrupt the service through his witchcraft. One day, he came to a service where people pray in tongues. All the demons left him, and he was converted and was baptized. How much more? There's power, all right? And it's a tremendous privilege to be able to pray in tongues. You know, Jewish tradition says that the high priest, remember, once a year enter into the Holy of Holies, and then they sprinkle blood. And Jewish tradition says that after the high priest sprinkled blood, he would speak in a foreign language. Then after he come after the Holy of Holies, he couldn't remember a thing. Let me tell you, what is that? They couldn't understand it. They kind of puzzled. What? This tradition, why they speak in a foreign language and after that, forgot. You know, the Bible tells in Acts chapter 2, as they were filled with the Holy Spirit, they speak in other tongues. All right, they were filled with the Holy Spirit and begin to speak in other tongues. Now, question, how come after sprinkling of blood, only the high priest can speak in tongues? See, it's a beautiful picture that the Holy Spirit can only come to you when Jesus Christ died for us on the cross. In other words, if blood is not shed for us, in our sin, in our human sinfulness, the Holy Spirit come, boom, you die. Because how many of us know a sinful man cannot stand a holy God? The Holy Spirit is God. When it comes in, you finish. But we are not finished when we are filled with the Holy Spirit, because the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us of our sin. And not only that, he gave us his gift of righteousness. And because of that righteousness, man, we have the Holy Spirit, and it's not to cure us, but to energize us. We've been talking about the role of the Holy Spirit in our everyday life. We talk about a little bit of recap, that when the Holy Spirit comes, he gives us the power to know Christ intimately. Look at John chapter 15.
He shall testify of me.
Wow, the Holy Spirit come to proclaim Christ, to testify Christ, and to tell us more intimately who Christ is. Now, why do we need to know Christ more intimately? Because the Bible tells us in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 2, the more we know God, the more we know Jesus Christ, grace and peace is going to be multiplied in your life. And grace is not just something aesthetic, beautiful. Grace means divine enabling. It means enabling in your profession, enabling in your relationship, in every areas of your life. And when you know Christ deeper, more intimately, that grace, that enabling, is going to be multiplied. And how could we know Christ intimately? The Holy Spirit, because it's there, all right, to help us enjoy freely. Say, freely. Everything that Christ has purchased for us on the cross. See, it says here in this passage, it's not like the spirit of the world. See, the spirit of the world has to do with, man, there's no free lunch. You got to work for it. Now, I believe in hard work, because the Bible says, don't work, don't eat, right? But if you just rely on work alone, your human effort, you got to limit yourself. Look at the story, amazing story of Nehemiah. Remember, he completed a project, but it's impossible for 90 years. Nehemiah built the wall of the holy city in just 52 days. And he himself said, it's because the gracious hand of God is upon me. So the key is God's grace, God's divine enabling in our life. They're going to help us go beyond the limit of our natural resources and the limit of our talent. Next, power of the Holy Spirit is power to overcome your weaknesses. Look at Romans chapter 8, verse 26.
Likewise, the Spirit also helps in our weaknesses.
Wow. The word helps is a beautiful word. It's a complex word in the Greek. We just simply translate in English, helps. Actually, it means together with Him, together with the Holy Spirit. He energizes, He helps us to overcome weaknesses. What are weaknesses? The Bible definition in the original Greek, the word weakness means sickness. And the more you pray in the Holy Spirit, how many must know, God is rebuilding, restoring your health. That's the story of this with a couple. His auntie got kidney problem. The doctor removed one of the kidneys and told her to them that the auntie, this the other kidney that's left behind, is not going to last very long. So naturally, the couple was very troubled. But one day, in the middle of the night at 2 a.m., they woke up, they felt an amazing burden for their auntie, and they began to pray in the Holy Spirit until the peace came. A couple of days later, brought the auntie to do the regular medical check. The doctor was amazed. The doctor brought in another doctor that had done surgery on that lady. And three of them were gleaning over the test result, the scans. And they said, didn't we remove the kidney? The other two doctors, yes, we removed the kidney. But how come from the scan result, we actually see two kidneys? And they tested the kidneys, brand new kidneys. Whoa, man. Even as you pray in the Holy Spirit, you are really creating. You are building. You are giving life to your body, giving life to your business, to your relationship, in other people say. Amazing. I mean, so many astounding stories. People in depression, people are going through stress, and they pray in tongues. God just gave them an amazing, astounding rivers of peace. And they got healed, all right, as they pray in the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit helps us in our weaknesses. But that word weakness also refers to areas in our life. The book of Hebrews says encumbrances and sins in our life. They're going to hinder the blessings of God in our life. Remember the children of Israel? They were about to enter the promised land. It only took 11 days to go in from Egypt to the promised land. Just walk straight. But it took 40 years. And after 40 years, only the children enter in. The adult couldn't. Because, you see, they didn't deal with the area of weaknesses in our life. For example, one of which is they always focus on the past. They focus on what is wrong. Focus on what is not instead of what God has blessed them with. Remember, God just blessed them with amazing gold, silver, abundance, and great health. None of them were feeble, but they were grumbling, murmuring. There were no onion. There were no garlic. And the point is that, you know, if your focus is always negative, look at your husband, look at your spouse, or looking at what he's not, instead of what he is. Okay, look at the country, instead of looking at what the country is, you look at what it's not supposed to be, and you get troubled, you get distressed. You have the wrong focus. Your job, instead of thanking God, at least you got a job. There are many people in the world today, no job for a year. I heard that. In many Western countries have no job for a year, and you guys have job. Give thanks, at least got a job. Oh, person on Malaysian highway, always traffic jam. At least there's traffic jam. Some places, no roads. All right, give thanks for what you have. And of course, sometimes we, like them, have a wrong self-image. Remember, we say that it is not the giants that defeated them. It was their poor self-image. They see themselves as grasshoppers. You look down upon yourself, you think you're spiritual. No, you're not spiritual. You're just not focusing what God say that you are. How many must know, you're not just anybody, you're a child of the Most High God. So the person on the right, you have seeds of greatness on the inside of you. You're not just anyone. Say, you're not just anyone. You are somebody. You're a child of the Most High God. You have seeds of greatness. Amen. And see, because we don't deal with areas of weaknesses, I mean, the people would just almost enter the land. Could have been just 11 days. They miss it. Why? Because they don't allow the Holy Spirit to deal with their life. Now, how to deal with areas of weaknesses now? Maybe you have an explosive character. Maybe you are like Samson, looking at the wrong thing. And you can't overcome that bad habit. How to overcome that? Well, people say, well, Pastor, very simple. If you have a will, there is a way. But the problem that if you just use a human strength and human will to overcome bad habits, after a while, you get exhausted. Just like pushing a balloon down a swimming pool. After all, you cannot tahan, cannot stand. Pastor, no problem. I'm a principled man. I have all the principle. I have all the laws and the 16 laws of success, 7 keys of leadership. I have all this. Now let me tell you, Moses has the best laws, God's law. But he himself couldn't enter the promised land. What's the problem? Not the law. The law is good, divine, perfect. But we, in our weaknesses, couldn't fulfill the law. And the beautiful truth in the Bible is that God understands that. God gave us His Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit helps us in our weaknesses. It says here in Ezekiel 36.
And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes.
God's spirit will cause us to walk. But this guy having problem with smoking, tried to give up with all the resolution and all the principle. He couldn't, and came to the pastor. Pastor, I tried. I couldn't. He was so discouraged. He was in despair. And pastor said, don't try. Don't try. Don't give up your smoking. Don't try. Oh, but I don't want the habit. I can't do it. And the pastor said, you can't, but Jesus can. That one single statement, you can't, you can, or the Americans say, you can, but Jesus can. The next day, the Lord just gave him the energizing power to overcome that habit, which has stuck with him for more than 10 years. See, it is the Holy Spirit. As you pray in the Holy Spirit, how many of us know God could help us to overcome? Another key that the Holy Spirit helps us is to remind us of Christ's word. John chapter 14.
But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you.
All things that I said. In other words, to bring to remembrance Christ's word. Maybe you've been reading the Bible. A word come to you. Listening to the tapes, Sunday services, a word, a rhema word, a revelatory truth that struck you. And how many of us know God's word, Christ's word, is the key to help us overcome our weaknesses. You know, sometimes, you know, from time to time, you have calamities, maybe hurricanes, maybe earthquakes, tsunami. You find preachers on television shouting and screaming, judgment, God is judging. God is judging America. And it's always America. Don't know why. You know? And television, it's always like that. Let me tell you this. God is not in the business of destroying people. The Bible tells does not come to kill, to steal and destroy. He come to give us life. And other people say, the apostle, then what about all the calamities? What about all the earthquakes? See, the Bible tells us in Romans chapter 8, this world is already in the process of natural decay since the time of Adam. It's not God's fault, all right? Insurance policy, they say acts of God. How many of us know that is not acts of God? It's just the process of natural decay since Adam's fall. But God is in the business of reconstruction. And other people say, amen. So God didn't send you sickness. God didn't send you cancer to teach you a lesson. No, no, no. All these calamities happen because we are living in an imperfect world. But God is in the business of reconstruction. God is able, in the midst of the calamities, in the midst of sicknesses, to cause things to work together for good. And other people say, amen. Sometimes, even through some adverse situation, like what Joseph gone through, and all the adversity, and God would teach us good revelation, truth, like the way that God dealt with the Israelites during the time of the wilderness journey, dealing the area of perhaps, as is that self-image, it could be arrogance, it could be a negative attitude, whatever areas. It is not sickness, it is the calamities, but it is the Word of God that God uses, the Holy Spirit uses, to remind what Christ has said to transform and change us. And other people say, amen. And the Holy Spirit gives us the power of knowing who you are in Christ. And, you know, the Holy Spirit is not just telling us who Christ is, but also tell you who you are in Him. Look at Romans chapter 8, verse 16.
The Spirit Himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ.
Wow! Holy Spirit, testify, witness, remind us, keep on telling us that, man, you're not just anybody. You're a child of the Most High God. You're heirs. When the Holy Spirit ministers to you, you've got to stand tall. You know that you are children of promise. You have all the promises that are going to cause you to be a success. And the Holy Spirit reminds us. Never tell you, one of the greatest temptations that you're going to experience in your life, the devil will come and make you dub who you are. Remember in the temptation, The devil said, Jesus, if you are the Son of God, the greatest temptation is to cause you to forget who you are in Christ. And the role of the Holy Spirit is to remind us who we are in Christ, that we are heirs. Look at John chapter 16.
And when he has come, he will convict the world of sin.
Some people got the wrong understanding of the Holy Spirit. Oh man, he's there to convict you of sin. No, no, the Bible says he convict what? You, child of God? The world, all right? He convict the world of sin. See, the problem we always regard the Holy Spirit as one. Well, man, if you see a prophetic guy, and some people scared of me when they saw me in the lift, thought that a man being a prophetic preacher, I'm going to be able to see sin in their life. That's not the role of the Holy Spirit. Even if I'm prophetic, I don't claim to be prophetic, all right? Even if I am prophetic, I'm not going to be able to see sin because that's not the role of the Holy Spirit. He's not there to convict you of your sins. But we project him like that, like a nagging spouse. Well, Proverbs says it's better to live on the rooftop breathing fresh air than down with a banquet with a contentious wife. How many have contentious husband like this? Don't put a hand. And yet we project the Holy Spirit like that. No, the Holy Spirit, the Bible tells us, look at verse 12. Convict us of righteousness. You know why? Because righteousness is a gift. Romans chapter 5, verse 17 tells us that when we receive the gift of righteousness, when we believe in Jesus Christ, all of us receive the gift of righteousness, we got to reign. Say, reign. That means you got to rule in life. That's the reason why Romans chapter 8, verse 14 says, for sin shall not have dominion over you because you're not under law, but under grace. See, why the Holy Spirit wants to remind you of the gift of righteousness? Because the more you understand grace, the more you know that you receive righteousness, not by your work, not by your good work, but as a gift. Wow! You're going to be able to reign. You're going to be able to overcome. There are so many testimonies, not just one, many. People just give up smoking just like that. Not because I tell them, thou shalt not smoke. In fact, I tell them, you smoke, you're closer to God. You go there faster. All right? We never mentioned, oh, you smoke, you go to hell. No. They just give up smoking. Why? Because every time they take a puff, we teach them. We take a puff. I'm the righteousness of Christ. I'm the righteousness of Christ. When you have a bad habit, you do all the bad things, I'm the righteousness of Christ. After a while, I mean, testimony, the puff, earlier they enjoy, but later on they say, wow, man, it smells like overnight durian. Stench on the rubbish bin. And they give up smoking altogether. Yeah, because sin is not going to have those bad habits is not going to have dominion over you because you're not under law, but under grace. I'm fully convinced if we just see ourselves as righteous and see ourselves not like grasshoppers, more each day, more surpassing favor is going to come upon you. You're going to experience much more breakthrough in your everyday life. If you don't look at your past and your unrighteousness, unworthiness, and very often that sense of unworthiness, we think it's being spiritual, is robbing us of the blessing. Just imagine you're singing just now, worshipping. Wow, man, just now the song was so anointed. And suddenly, you have a bad thought about me. This crazy pastor, cracking all the silly jokes. Then suddenly, it dawned upon you, wow, I'm supposed to be spiritual, I'm worshipping. And you felt unworthiness. Then you got distracted, oh, I'm not worthy. At that moment, Pastor Carey gave a prophetic word just for you because you're engrossed. I'm unworthy, I'm not worthy of this. You missed the prophetic word that can change your life. See, unworthiness can rob you of God's blessing. You recall the story, the testimony of missionary Connie Sievert.
10 years ago, I was told that I only had a few months to live because I had cancer. And my husband and I, at the time, we were missionaries to Ghana. And when we went back to pray about it, my husband and I, we just felt that the Lord was telling us we need to stand on His word and go back to Ghana, which, according to the doctor, that was a death sentence to do that. She said, you're going to die. I give you 2 or 3 months, but if you go to Ghana, maybe not even that long. But I was going to die anyway, so what was the difference? She said, your church will not let you go back. Call your church and talk to your pastor. I said, sorry, that's my dad, and he told me to go back. And as we journeyed back to Ghana, I was so sick. And when I arrived in Ghana, I just collapsed and I rolled down a long rampway. When I got to the bottom, I was unconscious. When I woke up and I saw my husband's face and I kind of mouthed him, I said, did we make a mistake coming back? And my husband, when I looked at him, he said, no, this is right. We've done the right thing. In March of 2001, I was in our church in Ghana. And during that worship time, somebody just stood up and gave a prophecy and said, the Lord is going to heal you. You've thought he's forgotten you. He is going to heal you. Come to the altar and you'll be healed. And I was on the front row and I crawled down to the altar. And I laid there at the altar and suddenly someone began to sing a song of healing. And from the top of my head to the sole of my feet, I felt like a fire go through me. I can't describe it in the natural, but I knew that I was healed. Amen? And I wish I could tell you that I jumped up that day and I was, wow, I'm healed. But I wasn't. I did not get sicker from that point, but I stayed the same. I did not become better. I just stayed at a plateau of where I was. And that confused me because I was thinking, healing means you get better, right? You know, I was saying, Lord, what is going on? What is going on? One day I was in my bed and I had my Bible open and I was just reading the scripture and I stopped reading suddenly and I cried out to God and I said, Lord, I don't understand. I know I was healed. Your verses have told me I was healed. And I know that experience. I know I felt your healing touch. No one can deny it. And I'm not getting sicker, but I'm not getting better. What's going on? I just don't understand. And right at that moment, the Holy Spirit just spoke into my heart. He says, you're not healed because you don't think you're worthy enough to be healed. You're not healed because you don't think you deserve to be healed. Immediately when that word came, it hit me in my spirit and I knew what he meant. But because of something I had done 15 years before, something that I felt I had sinned against God and against those around me, because of that, even though outwardly I knew he had forgiven me and I knew he was blessing me in my life, but yet deep inside, I had not forgiven myself. And I didn't really believe I was worthy because of what I had done, because of the mistake I had made, because of the sin I had committed. I thought, no, God, surely I'm not good enough. You can heal others, but not me. Now, this wasn't in my conscious mind. It was down, but the Holy Spirit knew. And right then, I just cried out to God from the depth of my being. And I just said, Lord, please forgive me. And Lord, please forgive my Let me forgive myself. Lord, your grace is sufficient to cover all that. And then, I'm telling you, then I was healed. Amen? That was the complete 100% healing. And I can say from that day, woo, 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 so fast. It was miraculous, my healing from that point on. And I've been healed ever since, 10 years. Amen? Praise God.
How many of us know that's the role of the Holy Spirit? To remind us of our worth and other people say, amen? Just like Gideon. I remember Gideon was threshing wheat in the wine press. And how many of us know that is a stupid thing to do? Because if you are threshing wheat, you need wind. All right? In a wine press, four walls, you're not going to have wind. Why do you think he was in the wine press? Because he was a chicken. I mean, he was a coward. He was afraid of the people around about him, the Philistines. And the angel came down and said, you rascal, you idiot. You have a great calling. You just betray your calling. Did the angel say that? No, the angel said, mighty man of war. But pastor, the angel didn't wear spectacles. Huh? Need to go for eye check, do a LASIK surgery. Cataract. No. The angel didn't see wrong. You see, the thing is that the angel lift him up to what he can be. That's the power of grace. And Gideon became a mighty man of God. Amen. That's the role of the Holy Spirit. Pastor, then where's the area of correction? Yeah, the word of God will correct you. Your good friend will correct you also. Because the Bible says in the book of Proverbs, wounds from our friends can be trusted, but the enemy multiply kisses. So yeah, everyone kiss you all the time, flatter you all the time. Careful, he may be your enemy. Wounds from a friend can be trusted. I mean, how do I get correction? You don't need Holy Spirit. Your conscience will correct you. But the Holy Spirit come, that in the midst of our weaknesses, in the midst of our guilt and condemnation, we begin to realize who we are in Christ. Then we will rise up tall to overcome that weakness, and other people say. Now, what is this? Just imagine, it's a real one. I got it from the Sunday school. So, probably bought it from the Pasar Malam. Now, just imagine it's a 3-carat diamond, and I throw it to the floor. And I grind it with my leg, a feet, and shoe. Just come back from the toilet. How many of you still want to have this 3-carat diamond worth $100 million? Just a few hands. Just because a little bit of dirt. Come on. Have more brain. You RLC people. So the person like, have more brain. Just wash it. This diamond worth $100 million. If I spit on it, still want it, no? You take a tissue paper, wrap it, and ask Elisha to wash it. Right. It's still diamond. And how many months? Despite what we have done, we are still righteous. How did the prodigal son come back to the father? He was in the pigsty. He did all the bad things. How did he come back to the father? When he realized, he got a revelation. How many of my father's servants have food to spare? He got a revelation of the greatness of his father's love. He got a revelation that he is still the son. How many of my father's son. Primitive, the key way to overcome sin is to realize who you are in Christ. You rise up tall, and other people say, amen. Wonderful Jesus. And that's what the role of the Holy Spirit is, to lift us up to what we can be. So, friends, God wants us to be like the Holy Spirit to one another. Always encouraging. Always be uplifting. You parent, be like the Holy Spirit to your children. When the kid come back with a report card, B, A, B, C. Huh? Son? With all the tuition classes, C? I see ya! Interpretation means you want to die. Alright? So no, we focus on what is wrong. So what's wrong. No wonder your kids don't enjoy fellowshipping with you. They're rather with the, what you call, jerks. How come my daughter, my son, couldn't see that that guy is a jerk? One C, you know. He's a jerk of jerks. And yet, that younger would fall for that jerk. Why? Because he was yearning for that love that he couldn't find at home. Because he always focused on what's wrong, instead of what's right. The thing is, there's a place of correction. Because you spare the rod, the Bible says, spoil the child. But have you built enough rapport, relationship with your kid? Have you deposited enough into her emotional bank account before you correct? The key thing is, when there is enough rapport, when she got a problem, she will not go to a drug addict jerk for counsel. He will come to you for counsel. But why he goes or she goes to the jerk? Because she don't feel condemned. She felt, oh, man, hi, bro. You're cool, man. Whoa. He come home. Yeah. No wonder. He'd rather marry a jerk than staying with you at home. And all the people say, are we still friends? Hallelujah. Okay. Be a Holy Spirit to your spouse. Don't always look at your spouse. He's not this, he's not that. Focus on what he is. You know, they say that a woman would not appreciate her husband until someone else in the office appreciate. Suddenly see all the good point. Before that, all the bad point. And before it's too late, focus on the good point. And other people say, and lift him up to what he can be. And other people scream. Lastly, power to prosper with wisdom. Look at John chapter 16, verse 13.
But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all truth.
See, when the Holy Spirit comes, and you pray more in the Holy Spirit, and sense His presence more each day, the Holy Spirit will lead you and guide you to all truths. Does it include your professional skills? Does it include your, perhaps, relationship skills? Does it include your money-making skills? Of course. And by the way, the first gift of the Holy Spirit is a gift of wisdom over and above First gift mentioned in 1 Corinthians 11 about the gifts of the Holy Spirit is wisdom. Not even miracles, though of course that is important. Not even prophetic word, though that is very important too. But the first priority, give of wisdom. The first description of the Holy Spirit in the book of Isaiah, Spirit of wisdom, of power and might. Not might mentioned first, wisdom mentioned first. And the first thing God wants us to get, look at the book of Proverbs chapter 4 verse 7.
Wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore get wisdom, and in all you're getting, get understanding.
God says wisdom is the principal thing. Wisdom is the key. In all things, get wisdom. And I believe wisdom is the key to success. Remember that there's no money problem. Ideal problem. And does idea come? Wisdom. Using the idea in the right way. There is no relationship or family problem. Only wisdom problem. Wisdom is the key. All right? And the book of Proverbs say, in all the pursuit, get wisdom. And by the way, wisdom is not knowledge. Not just knowledge. In the onset of the internet world, internet generation, knowledge is at your... I mean, you just the tip of your finger. Press, get everything, just Google search, anything you want, that's it. Yet the world is not safer. Economically, it's still a mess, big mess, with all the Harvards and the Yales and Oxford graduate holding the hem of this economic situation. The kind of situation is still in a mess. So wisdom is not just knowledge. And wisdom is not age. Hopefully, some of you grow older, you become wiser. But it does not naturally all the time. I've seen old people, I mean senior citizens, they just explode. They don't control their temper. How many of us know that it's not wise? Sometimes God took my girl, I mean my daughter, to a restaurant, a fine dining Japanese restaurant, one-to-one, heart-to-heart, wonderful time with my daughter. So I was just, the next door, just 10 feet away, was a couple, well-dressed, in a fine dining suit, and he was grumbling all the time, grumbling over the waiter, and asked the manager to come, over 5% discount. 5% stupid discount. That guy wrecked his whole night, which he cannot buy 1 second of time. Waste of time, I mean, with probably his wife. And sometimes we bring our kids out. We want to have a wonderful time with our kid. Over small little issue, we blow up. And the whole night is spoiled because we don't know how to control our temper. How many remember there's no wisdom? When you are wise, you know what to fight. You know what not to fight. You know what to win. Something you can win, but you lose the war. How many remember that? Just like the rat race. You run in the rat race. You won the rat race, but you're still only number one rat. Some of you catch it a little bit later. It's okay. Amen. God give you wisdom. The point is, how many of us know? That's wisdom. Know what to fight, when to hold our temple. And you can be old, but not able to control your temple. It's not wise. What you need to do is to pray more in the Holy Spirit. The more you pray the Holy Spirit, God will give you the wisdom. Pastor, the problem is that I prayed 20 years ago for wisdom, but how come it didn't come? Now, I'm going to tell you, it's a deep revelation. Wisdom is not an it. Wisdom is a person. That's why it's in the Holy Spirit. The Spirit of God is called the Spirit of Wisdom. Jesus Christ, in Him, is wisdom. It's a person. It's not about just, boom, you got a degree called wisdom. Dun, 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 dun. Oh, God, your graduate certificate, wise man. No. It's ongoing relationship, praying in the Holy Spirit. That's the problem with Solomon. Remember one day, he asked God for wisdom? And God gave him the wisdom. He became the richest man the world has ever known. He built God a temple. $60 billion. I don't know how much is that. I don't even know what is $1 million. It is $60 billion. His personal wealth in the 1920s was calculated in those days equivalent is about $200 billion. Today, even the richest man, no match for Solomon. He started his kingship age 20, but he died at age 60. What was the problem? See, wisdom is not an it. He got it, but he didn't continue with the person. He got distracted by all of the foreign gods, the foreign women, the porcupine, no, the concubines. He lost everything. So wisdom is not it. You continue to pray in the Holy Spirit. Every day I pray three items. Lord, much more surpassing favor, divine protection, and wisdom and discernment. Because wisdom, discernment are linked together. Grace and enabling are linked. So three items I pray every day. Because I know, it's not an it, it's a person. All right? And that's where, you know, sometimes we get confused with all kind of principles. But how many of you have read the Fourth Dimension by Dr. Cho? He's a great man of God. I respect him. He said, you want to pray for a spouse. How many of you are praying for a spouse? Don't put up a hand. All right? You got to be very specific. You got to visualize, he said. And I believe, I honor him. I respect him. And he said that you got to be very specific. Oh, what kind of a woman do you want to have? Oh, Pastor, I want to have a lady like Lady Gaga. I heard that she just covered up an egg. Oh, man, she must be very... You fool, just cover up an egg, you know. Oh, Pastor, no, I don't want Lady Gaga. I want something like Princess Cathy of Prince William. Oh, that grace. Princess kind. So you picture. On that hand, you go to the bookstore, also Christian bookstore, men of God that you respect. No. You don't go specific because you specific too much, huh? You limit yourself. All right? Oh, Pastor, I want to have something like Leonardo DiCaprio. Oh, man, so romantic. But you limit yourself, the book say. Maybe God wants you to want like a macho man like Brad Pitt. Muscle bulging, you know, bicep, quadricep, you know. You limit yourself, this book says. So you got confused, Pastor, which one? On the one hand, you got to be specific. On the other hand, no, you just rest. Let me, what is the key? How many like the key? Come back next week. The key is, it's not the method. It's a person. It's the Holy Spirit. As you're going to pray in the Holy Spirit, God will put you in the right place, in the right time. That's how I got my Carrie. Those days in Bible college, we always go to the rooftop and we had this grotto that we pray in tongue all the time. And God puts me in the right place. Right under my nose, not inside, no? Literally under my nose, because I'm the boss of the stationery stall manager. He was my secretary. He was appointed as my secretary. And it's right under my nose. And God puts me in the right place at the right time. All right? So how many of us know that as you begin to pray in the Holy Spirit, God will put you in the right place and the right time. So every day pray. Pray in the Holy Spirit. I mean, as you rest in Him, as you pray in the Holy Spirit, as you rest, God will just give you the knowing, the wisdom, the knowledge, and the creative ideas to do the right thing at the right time. And but the thing is, Pastor, how come I don't get anyone? Because sometimes, as charismatic, very often, we focus on the spectacular, and we miss the supernatural. Look at 1 Kings chapter 19.
And after the earthquake, a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a still small voice.
See, sometimes we look for the spectacular. Look at the fire. Look at the earthquake. Look at the dream. What a vision. Whoa, man, they all kind of this signs. And all this spectacular thing. And we miss the normal way that God speaks to us. And what is the normal way? The still, small voice. The gentle whisper. As you're going to pray in the Holy Spirit. And Pastor, all these voices, how do I know? Well, very simple. Is it in line with the Word of God? Number two, does it give you the peace? Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 says,
Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guide your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
The peace of God, together with the Word of God, is the key to confirm those ideas or those leading, that knowing is from God or not. So don't be misled by the spectacular, whether this lady asked God for a sign, and it was asking God for a decision whether to marry this guy. Opened her eyes, saw a shooting star. Wow, man, God's confirmed with a sign. So God married with this guy, and after a few years, that marriage broke up and breaks her heart. How many must know signs can mislead us? For all we know, the sign God may be saying, hey, your romance, it could be like a shooting star in and out. So, you know, signs and all these dreams can be imitated. Because you eat too much Hokkien noodle, you can also have dreams. Strange dream also. Pastor, today I have a strange dream. You know what's the revelation? You add strange food. Too much fried kway teow. It's possible, but all these signs, the Bible says signs, you know, Gideon, go for signs. Remember, Gideon, go for fleece. But, hey, church, Gideon is living in the Old Testament where he doesn't have the Holy Spirit on the inside, but you have the Holy Spirit, and He will guide you to all truth. And other people say, amen. Don't be taken up so much by the spectacular. You miss the normal way, the primary way that God guides us. All right? And also, don't be misled by people that come to you in a very super spiritual way. They always say, the Lord said this. I got this impression. I got this dream. I got this revelation. By the way, the Lord says, you invest into my business. Tell him, the Lord says, give you the fivefold ministry. Pia! The Lord says, you are supposed to marry Tan Amoy. I don't believe in all these things. Why? Because it is not in line with the Bible. Because the Bible tells us God respects our free choice. If God wants you to marry somebody, Hamramas know God will give you or you will have the chemistry. Pastor, what is chemistry? Feeling, lah. You know, oh man, no choice, Lord. I could have sacrificed my desire on the altar of the cross and marry Chan Amoy because that joker say, I got to marry Chan Amoy. No, you're the real joker because you listen to her. And the point is that you don't go for it. Unless, of course, you have the peace that will confirm and all of you will say. And very often, people coming around and saying, the Lord said this, I've got a dream, I've got this. It's just manipulating. It's spiritual manipulation. Even if you have a revelation from God, you don't have to say, that says the Lord. Like, go for a board meeting. I will not tell my staff or my board, the Lord says, do this. If I say like that, what's the use of the board meeting? If the Lord says, got to do it. No need discussion. Even if it is from the Lord. I heard it very clearly. I wouldn't say the Lord says. I would just say, this is what I propose. What do you think? What do you think? What do you think? And once we have made that decision, then I say, well, you know, I actually heard from God. Say it after the decision is made. Like you want to marry somebody and you felt the Lord leads you to somebody. I'm sure the Lord speaks to you. I'm not sure the Lord guides you. But say it only after the wedding. What do you hear? Not before. Before that, it is manipulation. How many say amen? Cannot say ouch. So don't let anyone mislead you by all the super spiritual way of just charismatic manipulation. Another thing is don't let people rush you into something. Oh, I got a pastor, I got this amazing offer to invest into that particular deal. Oh man, but the wife feel no peace. Isn't that amazing? Men would pay thousands of ringgit to go for a seminar to learn some principles on how to run their business when they can get it for free with their wife. Their wife don't have peace, you know. No, pastor, I had to go for it, man, because if I don't go for it, I miss 1,000 opportunity. No, let me tell you, you don't miss 1,000 opportunity when your wife got a troubling heart, a heavy heart. You miss 1,000 sorrow. So don't get rushed into a particular project when you don't have the peace. That's why even this building project, I'm not in a rush. I'm going to go take one step at a time. Look at Proverbs 20, verse 21.
An inheritance gained hastily.
That means the Hebrew word hastily means pressured into. in fear or because of greed at the beginning will not be blessed in the end. So avoid all this speculation, share market speculation. Avoid get rich quick schemes. You may suddenly get something, but in the end, you pay for it. Next, Exodus 23, verse 30.
Little by little, I will drive them out from before you until you have increased and you inherit the land.
So God wants us to increase, to inherit, but little by little, God will drive out the enemy. So they increase enough to possess. Some of them, so, you know, those so-called business opportunity to come, and don't be misled by emotional pressure. You know, some people can come to you, oh, you got to help me because you don't help me in my business. I'm going to die. But let me tell you this, if you help him, you die. I'd rather you don't die. And other people say, amen. Don't let people emotionally, all right, get you entangled into something which in the eventually, I mean, people that could have saved that money for the children's education because of sympathy. Well, if I don't help that friend of mine, he's going to die. So you help that friend of yours, he didn't die. Now you and your family and children die. I remember that it's not very wise. So don't allow those emotional tie to block you from hearing God's voice. Pray until God's peace comes. Don't let people force you to do anything. Just with the tears and emotion. You never find your pastor, hope not. I hope you will not let your pastor come to you and say, oh, church, you got to give your tithes and offering. Because if you don't tithe, we cannot pay electricity. We already got the notice from the Naga. We got only 10 days. Church, you got to give your tithe. If you don't give your tithe, my daughter Joy will have no milk. The other daughter will have to sell look. And then the third one had to sell ice cream. You know, have you ever seen a pastor being different? In fact, very often I said, don't give your tithe. You don't have to. You're not going to be cursed if you don't give your tithe. But pastor, why do we have to give your tithe? It's because of the windows of heaven. Is going to be open, and other people say. Look about Solomon. Why do you think that God gave Solomon such amazing wisdom that made him such an amazing billionaire? The night before, that evening, they got a dream that God gave wisdom. Solomon sacrificed 1,000 burnt offering in Gibeah. You only require one offering will be enough. But he did 1,000 times more. God said, hey man, Solomon is a guy that can pour my billions because he's a generous guy. Not because 1,000 offering buy God's favor. No, you don't buy God's favor. But God knows when you are generous, he can entrust you with much more. And other people say, amen. So basically, when you pray in the Holy Spirit, God will give you that peace to know you're not going to be manipulated, all right, but all kind of things. And sometimes the heaviness come because God is warning us something. The devil is up to something. And what you need to do is pray in the Holy Spirit that the devil cannot even begin to operate. I remember just some time ago, many years ago, my wife and my two daughters, Joy not born yet, they're coming back from Singapore, driven by a friend. At 8 o'clock in the evening, I felt heaviness. I don't know why. And I pray in the Holy Spirit. I pray in tongues. And when they came back, I asked them, what happened at about 8 o'clock? They said they almost met with an accident. See, if we not pray in the Holy Spirit, I would not have my wife and the two kids. I don't know where is Joy. The point is that Hamra Masla isn't a warning to help us. And we got to pray until the peace comes. And if you have the heaviness, and you don't need to know. Sometimes the Holy Spirit may reveal to you what you're praying for, and most of the time he doesn't. All right? And you pray until the peace comes. And the beautiful thing about praying on the Holy Spirit is that you don't have to stop doing what you're doing. You don't have to, no, you have a surgeon, you're doing operation. Suddenly you have heaviness. Oh, wait a minute. Hold the fourth anesthesist. And then you, Elijah, come, let's pray. You don't need to do that while you're doing your operation. You can pray under your breath. And louder also can, because they cannot hear you. It's under anesthesia. So, urabara shalom barakirian. You're a dentist when you're drilling. You don't, oh, ha, go. No, you while you're doing your surgery, the drilling, don't do that, okay. Pray in tongue. You can cook, you can do gardening, you can drive, and please, when you drive and pray in tongue, open your eye. And all the people say, Pastor, I don't know why. One day I'm driving, and I pray in tongue. Pastor, I see a lot of visions. I never seen visions in my life, Pastor. Angel came down, pat him on the back and said, No, you're not seeing visions. You are seeing reality. You're up there in heaven now. No. Hallelujah. Praise God. How many of us know the Holy Spirit gave us the wisdom to prosper? And other people say, Amen. Shall we all stand and come to the Lord's table? Father, we ask you that you bless this cup and this bread, that it may be able to really discern the body, to know your presence. It is not just ordinary bread. It is not just ordinary wine, but it may discern your body, the bread of life, that will bring us the fullness of life. You're going to give life to our dream, life to our body, here on this earth, not just in heaven. Thank you, Father, that this is truly not just ordinary wine, but the blood of the new covenant, which we partake, receiving grace, much more surpassing favor. Help us discern your body, even as we partake. The Lord Jesus Christ said, Take and eat. This is my body given for you. The Lord Jesus Christ said, This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Pour out for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Hallelujah. Praise. Thank you, Jesus. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. And all the people say, Amen. Amen.